On behalf of the Conductors Guild, I'm honored, privileged, thrilled, being able to introduce or present to you the Max Rudolph Award, Maestro Herbert Blomstedt. The Max Rudolph Award is given in recognition of outstanding achievement as a conductor and pedagogue and significant service to the profession in the realms of scholarship, advocacy, and ensemble building. So,
thank you. I'm honored to receive it. Thank you so much. Thank you. I'm bringing my greetings back to the Conductors Guild. I'm sorry I could not be with you another time.
That's life. That's music. Maestro Blomstedt, when I think of your career, what I think of first is your incredible ability of building ensembles. How did you get where you are today?
Well, I'm a chamber musician. I come from chamber music and from the organ, which is also a sort of ensemble. Many voices had to be harmonized and balanced together in accordance to the demands of the music. And when you deal with things like that, you get very sensitive. Also the organ, by the way, was very sensitive to the quality of each voice. And not every voice fits with another voice. It has to be done with great imagination and also great experience. The smaller the organ is, the more classic the organ is, I would say. It's more so. These giant romantic organs with 100 voices and more, it's not so much so. If you pull a couple of voices, more or less, it doesn't make very much difference. But the classic organs, every voice has a special voice, a special character and color. And to combine them is very interesting. The same thing in the orchestra, one gets very sensitive. It's different with every musician also, with every orchestra. So what you can get from one orchestra in one hall, you cannot get in another hall. And it has to be made on the spot. And one has to learn to react to what you hear. And of course to have a sort of vision, oral vision of how you want it to sound. I remember a young student who was, by the way, a son of a very great conductor. I don't tell the name, of a very great conductor. He was once sent by his father to rehearse the Dresden Staatskapelle. The father was sick that morning, so the son came and rehearsed. And after 1 minute, he said, "My father says the clarinets should sound more here." And then a couple of bars again, "My father says the horn are too loud here." Of course, he did not have any chance of making music with comments like that. You have to react to what you hear and not to come with preconceived ideas of how it should be. And that is something that, of course, you learn when you play chamber music yourself. Because the situation is new every second, it changes.
So do you still find time to play yourself?
Not very much time nowadays, no. I'm sorry to say, but I play chamber music with the orchestra.
Yes. So, when you conduct the orchestra, do you think of the orchestra as an organ where you can actually pull out a voice or...
No. It's just a parable. It's a parable.
Yes. Okay. So, when you started your career, you started out in Sweden. Then you came to Norway, Denmark, so you did all of Scandinavia, and then you went to the world. And I would like you to tell us a little about how this came to happen.
Well, it's very much by chance, especially if you are not born with elbows. I had good luck. I had good friends who observed me and gave me chances. I never asked for a job. It just fell into my lap. And at the right time, I think, looking back, always at the right time, when I was mature enough to go on to another orchestra, a better orchestra, bigger orchestra, I had the chance, and I just went. In the case of the real international career outside of Scandinavia, it was also quasi-political reason. It was the year of 68. In the 1968, it was the year where the Prague Spring was killed by the Soviets. Dubček was a little bit too liberal for them, so they thought it was dangerous, and they marched in with Russian troops and Russian tanks, but also with the troops from their alliances, Polish troops, troops from the German Democratic Republic, the East German Republic, and since as well the Leipzig Gewandhaus Orchestra, as the Dresden Staatskapelle at that time had Czech conductors. It was Václav Neumann in Gewandhaus and Martin Turnowski in Dresden. They quit the same day. And they cannot stand working in a country who sends soldiers to kill their own countrymen. So it was a very natural reaction. So overnight, these two orchestras, two of the best, not only in Europe but in the world, were without conductors. The Dresden Orchestra, they had a tour coming up of Scandinavia next year. No, I think it was in August or September, 68, they went to Sweden, and they had to have a substitute. And they went with a conductor from East Germany. It did not go well. The chemistry did not work at all. But in Sweden, apparently, they heard about me and wrote me a letter, asked if I would come and conduct as a guest conductor next spring. And I was happy, of course, for this offer, but also a little bit scared. I knew the orchestra only from recordings and from radio. As a boy, I heard often the Sächsische Staatskapelle in Sweden during the war and before the war, playing from Deutschlandsender. They had every Sunday morning at 11 o'clock, they had an orchestra concert in Deutschlandsender. And I and my brother, who was 3 years older than me, we always used to listen to that. That was the holy hour of the whole week. We went to school, both of us, and played cello. He played cello, I played the violin. And we were just, you know, crazy about music. So at 11 o'clock Sunday morning, we tuned in Deutschlandsender on this little Telefunken apparatus we had, and heard wonderful music. We simply discovered the great orchestra music this way. And very often heard announcements afterwards, you heard the Sächsische Staatskapelle play under the direction of Karl Böhm, the Mozart variations by Max Reger, or something like that. And that kind of sound that I could never forget. And I got an invitation to conduct them as a guest. It was like a dream. And I went and was overwhelmed, not only by the quality of the orchestra, but also of the quality of people. Wonderful, wonderful people. Not at all haughty. Many of the musicians I knew from Scandinavia did not like young conductors, you know. Don't think that you know anything, we know much better. That was the feeling that they gave the young conductors. I can understand that. You have to be able to take that. Not so in Dresden at all. They considered me almost as I was coming from heaven directly to them. And they were so happy to play with me and played just marvelously. And all of them tentatively, they asked me if I would come back regularly. And I came back next year for several concerts, and then they asked me to be their music director. So it took me some years to to say yes. Because even if the orchestra was wonderful, the country was terrible. But the people of Dresden, the concert goers were wonderful. They had a fantastic sense of seriousness when they listened to music. They came always to the concert, they were always sold out, always. Not a seat to be had. You could not buy a ticket to the concerts. You had to almost inherit a subscription. It was so sought after. It was like they could breathe some fresh air without politics when they went to a concert. Otherwise, it was all so Marxistly indoctrinated, and it stood up them up here. But you cannot completely, you know, make Beethoven or Bach into Marxists. So here they could live out their love of music. So it was a wonderful situation musically. But it took me 3 years to say yes. And after I said yes, it took the government 2 years to accept a conductor from a capitalist country. And of course their argument was, our country is the best country in the world. West Germany is just, you know, corrupt. And we have the best orchestras and we have the best conductors. Why don't you take one of those? But the orchestra said, we don't want those. We want this fellow. And they were very, 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 very strong in their opinions. So the government in East Germany, they just had to accept it. Otherwise the orchestra would go strike or would not play. So that's how it came to be.
So you crossed one Berlin Wall into the East Germany, but you sort of crossed another Berlin Wall, the Berlin Wall that goes through the Atlantic Ocean, because not very many European conductors get the option of conducting in America. So how did you do that?
Well, I did lots of guest conducting in America from the early 80s. And in the early 80s, several orchestras were looking for new music directors. And traditionally, especially at that time, now that's almost 30 years ago, especially at that time, they were not used to American music directors. They had the feeling that in order to be really good and carry on the tradition, the music director has to come from Europe. It's a little bit the same in Japan today, especially in Germany. They are so convinced that the real music culture that they want comes from Germany, not from France or Italy or England. Even if they also have wonderful orchestras and soloists, is fantastic, but the orchestral culture for them is German orchestral culture. And it was the same thing in America. So it has changed considerably since then, now. But then, I remember, especially in 84, I conducted five orchestras on one string. It was in Pittsburgh, it was Detroit, it was the Minnesota Orchestra, the Los Angeles Philharmonic, and the San Francisco Symphony. They all wanted a new music director, and they all gave me offers of one kind or another. Three of them gave me straight off invitation to become a music director, and other ones wanted me to be principal guest. They were all good, very good, surprisingly good. I was very impressed. Detroit was a terrible city, run down, and not very much interest for music for the general population. But it was a big city, and it was enough public, you know, among 5 million people, you can always find 15,000 subscribers. And the orchestra was great. Very well trained, very well trained. A little bit in the French style. They had French conductors for quite a long time. Paul Paré, for instance, had made a big job there. But also Pittsburgh was really wonderful. They had German conductors. Wilhelm Steinberg was in Pittsburgh for a generation or two. And I could sense that when I conducted the Pittsburgh Orchestra. They were very German in character. When they played Beethoven, Brahms, it was like conducting in Munich or Hamburg or Leipzig.